State Affairs.
State Affairs with Edmund Obilo. State Affairs with Edmund Obilo is live.
Senator Ali Ndume says we are at war. I quote him, "We are at war in this country, in the Northeast, and we are at war with criminals and bandits in the Northwest. We are also at war with herdsmen that are attacking, and we have security challenges in the North Central." Dear Nigerian, it's about securing the Nigerian state. There are violent gun actions in every corner. The epicenter is Northern Nigeria, where bandits reign. It is troubling time. Awake, O people. Awake. The program is State Affairs on Splash 105.5 FM, the Integrity Station. I am Edmund Obilo. Good to be with you again. At this juncture, it is not a mission impossible to declare a new order. And declaring a new order in our land is something we should look up to. To do this is to save the Nigerian state from pain and despair. Anguish that we stand in the hope that government would do enough to protect the people reminds me of the warrior who dropped his weapons by the river and immersed himself in the water to wash off the sweat of the battle. He is the picture I see. He forgot he was warned never to think the war was over because the river had stopped steaming. That he did not come out of the river is because he broke the promise he had with the past. When he and his men reached the cave, as the leading warrior, he entered and went straight for the pot as he was told. To avoid the enemy's laying ambush for him, he would take the sacred stone through the narrow road to beauty. Are you there? When he got to the edge of the land, what did he do? He buried the stone by the tree, by the road to hope, and made a gallant entry into the land. That is the picture I see. But he did not return to the land with his men. His men were consumed by the spirit of the cave. But he promised he would never abandon them when they gave up their hearts for his invasion of the cave to come with success. Now that the children of the men have grown up, they are asking questions he cannot answer. They are the war he has to fight, and the river was to be his succor, but it was his end. That we speak this way is not for lack of understanding of the language of the people. It is because we want to cage the fear of tomorrow as a result of the events of today. If you are with me, I want you to pause and think. You can close your eyes if you like. Set your mind to the future. The events of today can be scary. I hope you know. One of such events is the fury of guns and the killing effect of its bullets. The bullets fly around. Bullets flying around. It is the story of the Sultan of Sokoto, Alhaji Saad Abubakar III. It is the story the Sultan will tell. If I said I didn't sympathize with the Sultan, I was wrong. I feel the gruesomeness of the killings. I am appalled by the brazenness of the bandits and the laziness of the political leadership to stop the war of the state against itself. It is the picture I see. What picture do you see? How do you feel? It's our morning. It's our time on radio. It's our time to reflect on those issues and begin to say it's our time to make them right. Hey, the radio man is here. I'm here. You're there. It is Splash 105.5 FM, the integrity station. At this point, I tell you that tomorrow will come. But what will come with tomorrow? Is that what you see? All right. Let's go to the street as we await tomorrow.
Hardship. Her innocence does not matter. She is stranded, hoping to find a home. Does she dream? Dream of her in a school, in a good home, growing steadily and happy. But her place at the moment is in the street. one of the children from northern Nigeria running away from violence and poverty. She is not alone. Her relations are part of the journey to Ibadan in search for better life. They found themselves in Ibadan and discovered that in their cases, suffering is a companion jealously holding on to a lover. They are homeless. When they arrived, they took their places by the fence of Mokola Army Barracks, where they hoped to build their tents. But the army would have none of that. They must leave. They are scattered on the street in search of comfort. They end up as beggars. That is their reward for being born in Nigeria. They have shown the zeal to survive despite their conditions. Hadiza is already finding her way around. She ran away from the north to survive the violence there.
Hadiza.
Abinda
ya sa ni bara kesa raki. Ya sa ni bara.
Yesa ni ke bara. Ka ce shanun ki an kashe su. Ko? Yawa kamar ya ta wace hanya aka kashe wayannan shanuwa? Ta ya aka kashe su ko aka sace su ya aka yi?
Abinda wadannan da ka kasawa dan fatin nan da dan ka. Ya san suna bin mutane suna kashe. To ai suna.
He said the kidnappers, all those, you know, that stayed in the bush to collect their distance, stole her house, and then after stealing them, some of them were shot. So since then she has nothing, then she just have to come and start begging.
Depend on givers for succor and struggle to get their shares.
Do you do this all the time?
Not all the time.
Okay. And my how husband, do you feel? See them scrambling for...
I feel bad. My husband has a farm.
Okay.
He understood this and I just felt I should bring this to them. I feel sad each time I come. This is my route.
Okay.
Most times when I'm going in the morning, they sleep over there. They bathe there, they cook there.
Yes.
I have a pain in my home since then. I've been here once or twice asking that, can I adopt one of them? The process is much. I just felt, well, this is what I can afford to bring to them. Part of my husband's farm's produce, and I brought it to them.
Has government acted responsibly enough to help solve their problem?
Not in any way. It's corruption all over. Not in any way. But the ones that people like us can, I bring clothes here for them. Just do it.
Are we safe with this insurgency, with this people?
We are not in any way. We are not. All of these children, give them 1,000 naira, that's the maximum, they will do anything. We are not. And if I have my way, I want to pick one or two of them and adopt. If they will release them. So I've been here, I've spoken to their... They call the man one name, that I need just 2 girls. I'm a Christian. But that also is a constraint.
It's not. If we want to, we are Nigerians.
I've been here. Not once, not twice. I want to adopt 2 of them, train them, bring back them here some years after. Perhaps by the time they see the difference, others will be able to follow.
Of poverty, it becomes important to win leadership of the dangers the plight of the distressed poses. The fallout is the burning situation in northern Nigeria, where poverty is making war on the people. The World Bank, in its 2020 report, Advancing Social Protection in a Dynamic Nigeria, says the North accounts for 87% of the poor in Nigeria. Almost half of the number are in the Northwest, where the president of Nigeria, Muhammadu Buhari, hails from. According to the bank, regionally, the North lags far behind the South in every human capital outcome. The deposed emir of Kano, Sanusi Lamido, saw the folly in the practices in northern Nigeria that drives poverty. He warned the North before he was removed as emir.
Why is it that the poorest parts of this country are the Muslim parts? How do we define Sharia? How do we define Islam? Illiteracy? Malnutrition? Children on the streets? For Islam to prosper, we need educated Muslims. We need Muslims that are not begging. Believe me, if poverty continues in the North, Islam will disappear from the North.
Sanusi called on the North to save itself from destruction by tackling its social problems.
If you say wait until a girl has reached a certain stage before you marry her, you have not stopped marriage, you have not stopped the sunnah, you have simply regulated a certain element of it that has been shown to cause harm to society at this point in time. I've seen all the harms associated with all these. So it's fine to say to a rural villager, you should send your daughter to school. But it's not fine to say to the governor, why haven't you built a school? You don't have food security. You've got millions of children out of school. It's not the fault of the children that they're out of school. Somebody was supposed to build those schools.
As poverty grows in the North, children migrate to the South. They ought to be in school, but they are on the streets of Ibadan, left to suffer with their parents and relations. In her face is the genius of the future. The street is her pain. She has to go to school. A demographic health survey conducted by the United Nations Children Fund, UNICEF, and the Nigerian government shows that the population of out-of-school children in Nigeria has risen from 10.5 million to 13.2 million. Nigeria has the highest number of out-of-school children in the world. About 69% of them are in the northern part of the country.
Onyeka's message is loud enough. I hope we know the importance of love and unity. Oladele Do Joseph is on Edmund Obilo's page on Facebook. He says, Radio Man, I'm always impressed with the level of your optimism about the frail chances of Nigeria to survive as one nation. Obilo, your zeal, your faith, and belief in one Nigeria must be driven by one thing that none of us can see. However, I look true beyond the horizon, and I can tell you without mincing words that Nigeria as a nation is about to collapse beyond redemption, because our current predicament are worse than being in the real war time. Oladele Dewu Joseph says Nigeria is at war with itself. It looks irredeemable. Oladele Dewu Joseph, I feel your pain. I know how you feel. There are times I feel that way too, despite my optimism. But the more I think of the bad side, the more I remember what we can do to salvage the situation. Can you share my optimism, Idowu Joseph? Why am I that optimistic? Because I just feel we can fix it. But I must warn. I get messages every day trying to tell me I should dump my optimism. That it won't work, that we are so different, that the Hausa is so different from the Igbo, that the Fulani is so different from the Ijo, that it will not work. I go back, I think. But the Igbo, the Yoruba, the Fulani, they all go to America and they live in peace. How come it works there? He comes from Hungary. He comes from Poland. He comes from Germany. He comes from South Korea. They go to America and they live well. I wonder how it happens. They come from Japan. They find themselves in London. They come from Jamaica and they live in peace in London. I wonder why the difference is not that obvious. But yet in Nigeria, they say they are so different. But when they are out there, they love themselves so much. It must be about the thinking. Don't you think so? When I see you, I don't see your tribe. It is part of what you see. When I see you, I see your humanity. I don't even know where you are from. Most of the time, I don't want to know. But if you see me, the first thing you ask me is where I'm from, even in my own country. I now know your mindset. Look at Ndibu. There is a culture in Igbo land called the Osu culture. One of the happiest stories I read in recent time is that the Imo State House of Assembly want to abolish the Osu culture. Nothing pisses me off like that culture where Ndibu, we segregate particular communities because of what they said happened in the past, that they were betrothed to some gods. I come from a village called Umuokrokro village in a Isu local government area of Imo State. In that village, there is a community, they call them Umuosu. They are the Osu people. In that community, in Ebenato Ekwe, you have Umuokrokro, you have Elama, and you have Umudewuru. There are the three communities that makes up the autonomous community called Ebenato Ekwe. But at the fringes of that Ebenato Ekwe, you have a people called Umuosu that the other communities must not interact with. You must not marry their daughter. You must not marry their son, because they said their forefathers committed some, or they were betrothed to some oracles in the 21st century. And yet the Igbo man cries of marginalization. But the greatest marginalization is within itself. And you find this among Igbo communities. Oh, let's divide. Fine. You see, by the time you divide, those divisions that are not prominent now become prominent. Don't worry. Tomorrow, you might begin to see Ogbomosho will say, oh no, Lautech belongs to us. It must now become Ogbomosho University. We keep taking the divides in. But I also understand why some say they don't believe there's light at the end of the tunnel. Prince Sikiru Giwa is saying, I don't really pity this set of people because they see gross failure in the attitude of Northern oligarchy. They call it a resounding success. I read comments like this a lot. Oh, the chicken has come home to roost. The North must pay. It is now. Let them suffer it. You see, there is a war going on in Ethiopia now. And I'm pained that Ethiopia has gone to war against itself. It's going to be a long-drawn guerrilla warfare. Because I don't see the federal government in Ethiopia defeating that small Tigray region with ease. Because the Tigray people has fought war over time. Remember, they led the war against the socialists, led by the Derg regime, Mengistu's Hail Mary's regime. So they fought him for years until they toppled him and then began to govern Ethiopia. So you can't defeat such people. As I'm talking to you, the Tigray people have about 200,000 militias on ground. If the revelations of Ali Ndume is anything to go about, Nigeria does not have more than 200,000 soldiers. And the Tigray people have already well-trained 200,000 militias on ground. So bloodshed in Africa again. And I keep asking, why can't African tribes live together? Because the problems you find here, you also find in Ethiopia. By the time you study Ethiopia, you then ask, are we going to go to war again? Now let me come back to that comment, that the North should feel the pain. You see, once the North is biting bullets, the South should wait for its turn. What happens to war? It spreads like fire. You can see bandits already moving in into Southwest, staging attacks on the highways. And you think it will reach you? You can see most of the beggars from the North on the street. What do you think they are running from? They are displaced Nigerians running away from war. As they run, some of them will come with the violence and it will spread. If you are serious about the Nigerian project, you should be worried about what is going on in northern Nigeria. I am worried. The reason I'm talking about it this morning, dear Nigerian, it is uncommon to see the Sultan of Sokoto, Alhaji Saad Abubakar III, subdued by his message and weakened by his helplessness. In this case, his anguish is palpable. He says the security situation in northern Nigeria is dangerous as it is depressing. On Thursday, 26 November 2020, the Sultan, speaking at a gathering of religious leaders in Nigeria, under the platform of the Nigeria Interreligious Council, NIREC, tells the world that AK-47 wielding bandits reign in the communities of northern Nigeria, where they kill and take citizens hostage for ransom. By the extremism of the marauding bandits, the Sultan declares the North the worst place to live in Nigeria. Let's quote him. People think the North is safe, but that assumption is not true. In fact, it's the worst place to be in this country because bandits go around in the villages, households, and markets with their AK-47. They stop at the market, buy things, pay and collect change with their weapons openly displayed. These are facts I know because I am at the center of it. That's the Sultan. You know what that means? that the authority of the states has been contested, that the state itself is losing authority, that the state cannot govern. That's what it means. The Sultan describes the level of violence, having visited endangered communities in company with the governor of Sokoto State, Aminu Waziri Tambuwa. I quote the Sultan again. A few weeks ago, over 76 persons were killed in a community in Sokoto in a day. I was there alongside the governor to commiserate with the affected community. The Sultan calls for solution before violence envelopes Nigeria. He admonishes religious leaders to promote peace, love, and unity. The Sultan cries, I sympathize with the Sultan. I feel for my brothers and sisters in northern Nigeria. We must end the bullets. Adewale Owosheni is here. Adewale, it's good to have you on State Affairs.
Thank you very much, Mr. Edmund. Good morning.
You feel for the Sultan?
Of course I do.
Why?
My own feeling is more on, you know, raising the fundamental question of, okay, the state has been let loose. And like I said previously, sometimes ago we talked, anarchy seems to be a mode of operation now. And one thing is quite impressive these days about the turn of, you know, the political manifestation in Nigeria. Now we see the elite, people who are in the place of, you know, authority, also coming out to speak. So, but my own fundamental concern is, why are we having that now? Is it perhaps because some of them are also feeling threatened of the situation within the state? Because recent we heard of what happened to the Olufan of Ifon, why some people got on the road, and then the driver trying to manipulate, and in the end the man lost his life. And it's becoming clear and lucid now that even the state, the government, is not safe and is struggling hard to save itself from itself now, because I think for some times the citizenry, I've been feeling the bad brunt of the of this, you know, unloose state control, lack of security and hope. But now it's getting to the headlights. They are also feeling threatened. And I wouldn't know, mine is a mixed feeling for the Sultan, because number one, security is on all persons, or we all are involved. It is a common mandate that we all have to ensure that we are safe and whole. And I wouldn't know the level of his sympathy, genuinely. That's why I might have a misfeeling for him, though. That's the kind of feeling I do have for the Sultan.
The Sultan is a retired brigadier general in the army. You see, we have reached the point. Adewale Owosheni is hanging out with me on State Affairs. We are here doing the analysis together. As we go, we expand the talk. After this break, I'll be speaking with the son of the first Prime Minister of Nigeria. I'm talking about Dr. Abdul Jalil Tofar Balewa. Remember, it's about national security. Don't go away.
State Affairs with Edmund Obilo.
Flash FM 105.5.
Jane, I need to get to Solar Telecoms at Mokola now. I need to get an AC for the office and a TV set for the reception. Should I go to the Mokola or Challenge or Palms Mall? Or which do you think is closer? This should not take more than 30 minutes.
No, Sao, it shouldn't even take up to 10 minutes. There's a new Solar Electronics store at J. Allen Dugbe Ibadan.
New Solar Telecoms at J. Allen Dugbeke. When? How? Where?
Yes, the Jagaban of electronics and phones in Ibadan, Solar Telecoms, has landed at J. Allen Ibadan. Step up your game and visit Solar Electronics Showroom at number 15 of Bafemi Awolowo Way, J. Allen Ibadan today for the best flat screen and curved TV sets, AC units, gen sets, deep freezers, fridge, gas cookers, and lots more at the lowest prices.
Thank you for your patronage, sir. This is your special gift.
Lovely.
There's so much to go around at Solat Electronics Showroom at J. Allen. Visit us today and get yours too. Or call 0907-434-9785 or 0701-684-1630 or visit solatonline.ng. Solat Telecoms, the Jagaban of phones and electronics.
Uncle Dentist, what can be cavities and how Colgate take they protect my teeth from cavities? Shey, they use Kung Fu?
No, dear. Now, hold for teeth, they cause most tooth pains will be cavity. But if you use Colgate Maximum Cavity Protection, take brush every day. The confirmed formula could help keep natural calcium inside our teeth. We could protect them from tooth decay.
Time don't reach, so upgrade to the chosen toothpaste Colgate. Because Colgate locks calcium in.
Keep out. Now, the Nigerian Dental Association, they recommend Colgate.
Hello, Bayo. Ojo no maro se nyeni mo wa bayi. Ni be loko mi denu ko lesi. Koda mi o ni.
Dakun o lowo pe to lati tesi waju pelu pe yi.
Rara o ko jeje be.
Kini idi?
Ah, ipe ise pataki gan ni.
O ba ti research ngba na.
Be ni sugbon mi o si ni bi ti mo ti le research bayi.
O se kuku yawo pe lenkan.
Eh? Yawo pe ke bawo.
Pelu Glow Borrow Me Credit. Oli yawo pe ko se so pada leyin na. Be lo ronun. Iwo sa ti pe *321# ko si je lase be.
Looto, o ti la waju. Bayo, bi mo se nso lo, oko mi denu kole nibi.
Soro bayi, sanwo leyin na pelu Glow Borrow Me Credit.
Unlimited.
Muka don't land better woofu for grand, oh! Hey, from October 2020, if you buy comfy mattress, them go summer you better mosquito net. If na flora mattress you buy, hey! You go collect correct bed sheet with two pillowcases join. This a woofu not be forever, oh! Oh, yeah, alele! Make na go Muka distributor way near you. Them go yanu na more informate for the terms and conditions.
Muka, adding comfort to life.
Ọ̀rẹ́ wa, ìjẹ́ egbògi yóyó bitters ń bá àgọ́ ara rẹ ṣọ̀rẹ́ bí? Ìtumọ̀ ni pé, ṣé ò ń lo egbògi yóyó bitters lójoojúmọ́? Yóyó bitters, egbògi tó ń dáàbò bo ara kúrò lọ́wọ́ àrùn àti àìsàn. O lè máa lo yóyó bitters bí oúnjẹ aṣaralóore tàbí kí o máa lo bí oògùn gẹ́gẹ́ bí ìmọ̀ràn àwọn dókítà. Yóyó bitters, egbògi tó ń fọ gẹ̀dẹ̀gẹ̀dẹ̀ ara ni. Yóyó bitters, yóyó bitters. Ọ̀pọ̀ inú tó kún lákùnjù gbé elura kára rẹ ó yá gágá. Yóyó bitters àmárẹ ẹni jí pépé fúnni lókun àti ṣiṣẹ́ akin. Ìdí nìyí tó fi gbọ́dọ̀ ní yóyó bitters lárọ̀ọ́wọ́tò rẹ nínú ilé lọ́fíìsì níbikíbi. Ó wà lólómi lóní gel àti ní kóró. Tètè lọ ilé ìtajà oògùn tó bá súnmọ́. Yóyó bitters ọ̀rẹ́ ìmùlẹ̀ tí ò gbọdọ̀ wọ́n ni. Yóyó bitters kára ó mọ́ tinú tòde.
Your favorite shows live on Facebook.
All right, 22 minutes before the top of the hour right here on Splash 105.5.
This, yes, of course, is Splash 105.5 FM. We are the Integrity Station and we're reaching...
Yes, yes!
You can watch your favorite presenters and listen to your favorite programs on our Facebook page every day. Go to Splash FM 105.5 on Facebook, like our page, and get updates when your favorite program is streaming.
Do you need a fully furnished, nice and comfortable hostel accommodation in University of Ibadan? Or a place for seminars and executive trainings at the same venue? You do not have to worry. Adebayo Akande Hall suits your lodging needs and provides you a home away from home. Adebayo Akande Hall is a four-star hostel built in a serene environment with constant supply of electricity. It has fully furnished rooms that gives you great comfort at an affordable price. Adebayo Akande Hall is located at Ajibode Extension, University of Ibadan. To make reservations, visit www.adebayohall.com or call the numbers 0805 0805-699-8718. 0805-699-8719. 0805-699-8720. And Debayo Akode Hall. Built for comfort. Built for you.
Flash FM 105.5.
In the global village of conflicting ideologies and complexities, understanding systems and schemes through awareness and social reconstruction becomes expedient.
They never told you how you offended them?
I'm not on trial, so I can't go before them.
Join the radio man, Edmund Obilo, on State Affairs for local and international politics, security, extensive economic analysis, interviews, and world power play.
Nigerians must choose the path they want to follow. Follow the same looters and sponsors of violence who control the political structures, or encourage the formation of a new leadership team.
Be a global citizen and join the radio revolution on State Affairs. State Affairs with Edmund Obilo. Radio just got deeper.
Remember, it's about national security. It's about securing the Nigerian state. There are violent gun actions in every corner. The epicenter is northern Nigeria, where bandits reign. Troubling time for the state. Awake, oh people, awake. Are you on Instagram? You can leave a message for me. Are you on Facebook? I'm here. Muslim Adiga is on Facebook. He says uncertainty everywhere. Patrick Osazuwa John, how are you this morning? He says all systems produce output. It is what we put into the system that it produces. And so is leadership and a country or a region. Everything rises and falls with leadership. Patrick Osazuwa John, thank you for that intervention. Makestos Adishino Shinowo has intervened on Facebook. He says, good morning, Edmund. Sometimes in a bid to seek for an overdue peace, there must be war, as those who ought to give out the peace are unwilling. Same can be said of the Nigerian state and her embattlement with widespread insecurity. I see your point, Makestos Adesino Shinowo. But war is not good. War is not good. I'm interested in war stories. And I've come to the, as a younger person, there were times I would tell my dad, enough is enough, let's go to war. My dad would say, you've not seen war. He said, you don't want to go to war. He said, son, you know, I fought in the Biafran Civil War. I was on the war front for 3 years. He said, son, don't talk about war. I will not support any war, my father would say, because he has seen war. Go to the villages in Zamfara and you see the effect of war. Go to Maiduguri. Children that cannot find their mother. A bomb lands in your backyard. You take off. Before you come back, your children are gone. You can't find them. Picture that scene. Or that you are even running. It's until after an hour you remember, oh, where is my husband? And you might not even see him again. No more wars. Let's go to Dr. Abdul Jalil Tafawa Balewa. Let's talk about Northern Nigeria. northern part of the country where you come from. In Katsina, bandits are on rampage. In Zamfara, people are being killed. In Sokoto, there is no peace as violence is taking over. What about Bornu? What is going on with northern Nigeria? I mean, not west, not east.
Do you remember Dazuki, who was the NSA at one time?
Yes.
He, with Jonathan, he spoke so harshly about Boko Haram one time and that they would defeat Boko Haram within a week. What happened? Hafiz Rengen, an IG of police, who also boasted that he was going to do something to the Boko Haram, not only did they do something to him, they went to the headquarters of the Nigerian police, Edit House, and held it to ransom for a while. Very recently, General Burata spoke to the president, and the president wanted action taken on these hoodlums. The following day, or 2 days afterwards, they killed like 120 people in Katsina and about 70 or 90 in Borno. Just a few days after any of these big VIPs make noise, Boko Haram come out and devastate our people. What happened in Katsina, for instance, it was reported that these hoodlums came in on motorbikes and went into this particular village and said they were going to talk to the people, talk to them, and then later they brought out their guns and started shooting. The district chief of these people are still, as we speak, are still with this Boko Haram or whoever they are. Somebody or some people are funding Boko Haram. We need to find out where the funding is coming from.
The northern part of the country, according to some analysts, is bogged down by its custom, by deep poverty. That the northern part of the country is also bogged down by religion.
I doubt that very much. Libya is a Muslim country. When it was run by Gaddafi, it was run fairly well. The quality of life of the people was excellent. UAR, the United Arab Republic, Abu Dhabi, Dubai, and so on, are Muslim countries. The quality of life of the people is good. Qatar, Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, the same. So it's not about religion. It may be about interpreting religion or mixing culture with religion and getting a very bad product from that. You see, our culture is feudal. It is such that if there is a rich person, he maniacally have a lot of people around him that he's taking care of.
Is that not poverty?
And it has made our system very lazy and not focused. There's absolutely no reason. The North is extremely rich. In the periodic table of elements, we have about 56 elements, and we have close to about 15 of the richest metallic elements in the world. In the North, we have an abundance of gas, we have very good land, and even in the far north, where the Sahara is encroaching, we have the technology of making it fertile. Some unwillingness to change has come over us over time. When the north, southeast, and western region were taking care of themselves, they survived well, and they were doing well at their own paces. It wasn't until we had the military, who are used to having central commands, that we now have a centralized government. It's the leadership from the region that needs to be blamed and need to be changed. But we can only change that leadership texture by educating our people better, for them to know what their rights are, what they should expect from those leaders. And if they don't get it, they can vote them out.
This is a part of the country that has the highest number of out-of-school children. And this is a battle of the mind.
I have degrees in medicine and nuclear chemistry. I'm from the north. There are so many of us like. So it isn't a matter of intellect. You see, using the crutch of religion and culture can be offensive sometimes to progress. Our Nigerians are not supposed to be beggars. They are supposed to be students of Islam and of the Quran. We had twisted that around to our dismay, because when you look at the countries around us, Republic of Benin, Republic du Niger, Chad, Cameroon, Northern Cameroon, they're all French speaking. Every single one of them can speak English also. We haven't even gotten our part of the country to be able to speak English only. There's nothing wrong with these children going to Quranic schools. There are millions that had to do that. You go to Quranic schools, maybe in the evenings or on weekends, but you learn what the Western education can give you also, because that's where you're going to be able to make ends meet in an atmosphere like this. After all, English is a lingua franca.
State Affairs with Edmund Obilo is live.
Speaking there with Dr. Abdul Jalil Tafar Balewa, that interview was done in June 2020. Hakim Yakin is on Edmund Obilo's page on Facebook. He says, inasmuch as there is no crime-free society anywhere in the world, widespread insecurity in Nigeria is caused by injustice and poverty, perpetrated mainly by the ruling elites. Victor Samuel says it is high time. Oh, I missed that. My system just updated itself. Okay, I'm back. Victor Samuel says it is high time we stop healing our politicians. Will you tell me that Ndume did not know the type of person Maina was before standing as shorty for him? They are all bunch of... All right. Thank you. I got you there. I know what you're trying to say. It's not about healing. It's about quoting what the person is saying. Hilali Ndume? Who hails a senator in Nigeria? Do you want to hail a senator? You can go ahead if you like, not me. I feel the National Assembly cannot do good. That the National Assembly has been consumed by greed. The failure of the Nigerian state is also the failure of the National Assembly. It's not just about Buhari. Buhari is just one man there. I'm beginning to feel that the greatest failure of the Nigerian state is the number of men and women we send to the National Assembly to make law for the people. Those who make law should be among the purest form of the people, because upon the laws they make that the state is governed. So when those who make laws are the biggest lawbreakers, you begin to ask, when will the state fly so high? But remember, I tell you,
that in our time we'll build aeroplanes so that our people will fly so high. With the situation described so far, peace has become elusive. But take note, peace and progress are functions of outstanding official policies. The reason bad leadership and endemic corruption are threats to national security. Chukwudi Njoku is here. Chukwudi, it's good to have you on State Affairs.
It's a pleasure.
How do you feel about the state of affairs in your country?
The state of affairs in Nigeria currently, it's quite worrisome, I must say, in as much as one must always be hopeful. Yeah, but the issues going on in the country, from security to administrative issues and issues in the educational sector, health sector and the likes, it's something that calls for concern, and I must say it's really worrisome.
And you are a researcher trying to solve one of the concerns. You know, sometimes I feel for researchers like you. Who are you researching for? Who cares about what you have discovered?
Yes, so it's always been a challenge for researchers knowing that the system may not actually take into consideration what most of their findings are and implement them in making the country better. It makes it kind of discouraging for researchers to, you know, even put more efforts in doing their research and coming up with findings, knowing that there's a bridge, there's a huge gap between the academia and the policy formulation itself. So we have this notion that the research we're doing will not be put to use. But notwithstanding, we still make efforts to carry out our research and find a way to, you know, send word out. You know, like speaking here today is one of the ways we can talk about our findings and see if the right ears will listen and put them to use.
Let me tell you that Chukwudi Badibo Njoku is a PhD candidate at the Department of Geography and Environmental Science, University of Calabar. He's working on a project with the title Pastoralist Farmers' Conflicts in Nigeria, Socio-Ecological Drivers and Transformative Pathways to Addressing the Conflict. Buhari should be looking for young men like this and saying, what are your findings? I need to see you in Asurok now. That's the kind of president I'm looking for. Buhari should be asking Adewale Owoseni, what are you researching on in the Department of Philosophy, University of Ibadan? I need to see your works on my table now. It is the works of research that drive development, not the thinking of one politician who cannot relate the issues of theory and practice. Governance is a serious business. It should be run by those who are fascinated by good ideas. What do you find here? What do you find? Remember, it's about national security. With the kind of leadership we have, the people are trapped by poverty and violence. As self-preservation, an essential law of nature, is threatened, the people agonize about the inadequacies of their government. To ensure their survival, a people elect a government to serve their security and common good. As collective survival becomes national security, the people are defended from external and internal forces out to subdue and destabilize the state. The military is therefore established to upstage the forces of destabilization. If the military was alive to its responsibility, why are bandits riding roughshod on communities? Look at this story. Suspected bandits strike on Thursday, 26 November 2020 at a Legbeka community along the Ifo Benin Highway, killing a prominent traditional ruler in Ondo State, Oba Israel Adeosi, the Olufon of Ifo. Persons traveling with him were kidnapped. What kind of story is that? Look at this. The Senate leader, Yahya Abdullahi, states that 350 million of the 500 million illegal arms in West Africa are in Nigeria. How do you feel? Like in Benin City, in the past 2 weeks, the boys in Benin are killing themselves. I don't know the figures to believe in anymore. But from the information I'm getting from Benin, more than 100 boys have died. And yet we say there's no war. They call it court war. They call it court war. But remember, they all behave alike. Even the bandits in Katsina. We're just having different names for all of them. Shekau and Co. in Borno are called terrorists. We call some herdsmen. We call some others bandits. The ones in Benin, we call them courtists. The ones in Rivers are courtists. Then the ones inside the sea are the militants. Okay. Adewale, you are following the letters. You are following the spirit of the moment. You are projecting into the future. What do you see?
If it is violence, if it is terror, no matter the semiotics we use to wrap it, it's still the same. But I feel that even when we place, you know, the identities of some as bandits, some others as militias, and then some others as terrorists, you begin to ask if the government actually knows what defines or distinct some of these, you know, name callings from each other.
They are also hoodlums.
Good. The idea of looking or solving for their green pastures or livelihood to encroach on other people's spaces. I think the response of the state should be uniform across all these movements.
You know, what I see sometimes is competition for the state. Young persons that have guns are coming up to say, we need a share of our state. And they come in and they make sure they get the share with their guns. And we call them bandits. In your study on pastoralist farmers' conflicts in Nigeria, how has environmental factors caused this war?
Okay, that's a very interesting one. You just used the phrase competition for the state. Yeah, but based on my study, I would call it competition for resources. Now, some scholars in the past have highlighted that when resources, natural resources, dwindle, conflicts would arise and increase. So my study buttresses that fact based on some of the findings I have discovered that the reduction of resources, land and water resources, is one of the major factors which is causing the conflict and making it to increase over the years. This is so because in the past, in the pre-colonial times and in the colonial times as well, the conflict between the pastoralists and the farmers were quite minimal. But as time advanced, as desertification started to occur, as drought occurred, particularly in the 1970s, there was a particular drought that made lots of pastoralists in the north to move down south and started sedenting that staying back in the south. We started having incidents of conflicts which were caused by the interaction of pastoralists and farmers. So I would say it is more of a resource conflict more than even any other factor which are more popular, like political factors and religious factors.
It's not really a Fulani factor?
Well, because the major actors are Fulanis and the farmers, and then in most cases it seems as if it is as a result of the Fulanis moving into areas which are not like majorly their natural abode. It's seeming like a Fulani factor. But the major issue which my study has shown is that it's a resource problem, and which has been increased recently by the lack of resources, natural resources, land and water resources.
Adewale, what has Fulani got to do with it?
Yes, I would also a bit step up on what he has said. I think that we also need to go, you know, beyond the geographical zones of Nigeria to understand the dynamics of, you know, the migrations of the Fulani. So he talked about resource conflict, resource use or resource conflict. And then I would like to link that to, you know, primarily to the factor of the shrinking or the regression of the Lake Chad, where, you know, most of these pastoralists, especially within the ambit of West Africa, you know, where they get most of their resources in terms of feeding and grazing their cattle from. But, you know, at the point of the regression of the Lake Chad, which, of course, fostered some kind of migratory movement or mobility down into the west through Chad, through from the Sudan through the Chad to Cameroon, now down to the Nigerian contest. Mm. The contestation of species now began to creep in gradually. Mm. Mm-hmm. And I think the state was slow to respond to the porosity of, you know, border flows, especially the Nigerian state, especially from this other part of, you know, the West African fringes. And to date, it has continued to be that way. But something that also seems fascinating about it is that pastoralists have something innate or intrinsic to their nature. They are basically nomadic. They are nomadic, but in the evolution of the modern state presently, they are geographical markings of boundaries and territory. Yeah. And that is the only way Nigeria in West Africa and other states can claim sovereignty. But, you know, in a case where you find some, you know, I would like to say complicit involvement, especially through state kind of sponsored, how will I put it now? State kind of sponsored or repressive acts. Yes, exactly. Thank you for that word. You would know how far this kind of issue is very complex and complicated. So there are so many factors. Even the religious ethnic factors can also not be, you know, underrated. So people find it difficult to clue into the idea that, okay, the majority of the North is dominantly Muslim. And sometimes they link the motivations of the pastoralist in terms of expansion of territory, they link it to this. And then down south, you have Christians, dominantly Christians. And then, you know, it has a way of also labeling farmers or settlers. Yeah, supposed settlers.
What I also see sometimes is the clash of modernity or modernization with civilization. Because if you look at some of the stories involved, you can see primordial times competing with modern times. You have well-defined state boundaries. You have state laws that give power to people to run their businesses. But you have a primordial system that allows people to also move their cattle from place to place. And certainly there will be clashes. If the states were futuristic, the states around the Lake Chad Basin should have known that something was happening to the Lake Chad Basin. You begin to plan what happens to those who use the waters around the basin. You begin to plan for them. Did the state do that?
Yeah, the state did not do that, and that is where they failed. Now, another issue with the Lake Chad Basin, which used to be a major area for pastoral and agricultural activities, is the fact that that area seems to be a hotbed for terrorism, which some people have also said is as a result of resource contestation. So that area also it's not conducive, has not been conducive for agricultural and pastoral activities. So we find out that the resources available to pastoralists and farmers have also dwindled, not just as a result of drought or desertification, but as a result of terrorism in the northeast. So on the Lake Chad Basin, it's been drying, it's still drying, and nothing really has been done. And not just that river, not just the lake, other rivers in the area too are also shrinking, and nothing is still being done about it. So it's quite worrisome.
When you hear stories like these, you begin to wonder if Dubai is a desert country. Dubai is a desert country. Dubai, Abu Dhabi. But you see the way they manage their affairs, you would say they had futuristic leaders. What I see here is the insistence on primordiality. Oh, this is our culture. We cannot change it. This is how our forefathers lived. We cannot change it. When culture does not respond to inquiries, the people perish. The people perish. Now let's look at this. I have spoken to Dr. Abdul-Jalil Tafa-Balewa. He has given us some insight about what's going on and not. There's the question of the powers of the military. Could it be that the military operates with equipment and ammunition inferior to those of some of the marauders? Ali Ndume is the chairman of the Senate Committee on Army. He says Nigeria is at war. We are at war in this country, in the Northeast, and we are at war with criminals and bandits in the Northwest, he says. He continues, we are also at war with herdsmen that are attacking, and we have security challenges in the North Central. Ndume says to end the war, the state must equip the military. I quote him, you find soldiers on the field rationing ammunition and insurgents come with latest arms. Ndume is not done. I have said it before. They seized AK-49 from captured insurgents while our soldiers are still battling with AK-47, and some of them are old because they were procured a long time ago. You even ask, how come we cannot even manufacture AK-49? Adam Smith in the 18th century states that the public funding of national defense is the first duty of the sovereign. The funding of a standing professional military force is tantamount to the survival of the state. The survival of the state is the defense of the territorial integrity, national sovereignty, freedom, government, people and values of the state. Note, by the absence of general and complete disarmament, maintaining armed forces sufficient for the defense of the state is irrefutable. We have reached that point. The lines are open, 080-915-51055. 080-569-96978. Remember, I have Chukwudi Njoku with me. We are hanging out till 11 o'clock. I have Adewale Owoseni of the Department of Philosophy, University of Ibadan here. We are looking at national security, and I know you are there too. So join the discourse here. You can leave messages for me on Twitter at E. Obilo. You can leave your message for me on Instagram at Obilo. I want to read your thoughts. I want to reflect on them. I want to reflect on your fears, your critiques, your anger, your hope. I want to reflect on them. Have you seen the car on my page? Adorned with the pages, adorned with the flags of Nigeria? You can see that truck. That truck is on the road to New Nigeria. Join the journey. Hello.
Hi, Edmund. Good morning.
Good morning, Lambert Oje.
Thank you. Well, optimism is a goal, you know, to keep sustaining this country and, you know, pulling it back from the brink, what is currently on the brink. And I hope those who are running the affairs of the country are sensitive enough to understand that, particularly the Inspector General of Police yesterday was saying he will never tolerate the kind of protest that happened recently. Well, in other crimes, what I'd expected from him, you know, was to come out and then give some, I mean, details of steps he has taken to ensure that police brutality stops, that intimidation by law enforcement agencies stops. So by doing that, you are indirectly stating the same thing he stated. But the situation where you come and tell people such a protest will not happen, a protest in the first place that he was not aware that it was going to happen, my advice to the law enforcement agents, together with the government, is to ensure that those things that led to the protest never happened again. Because if it continues, you know, the kind of protest we saw was spontaneous, and he was not informed before it happened. So my advice to him is to come to Nigerians and list those things that police and law enforcement agencies are doing to ensure that brutality and all those evils that we have seen in the past never happens again. That is the only way the protest will never recur. Thank you.
Thank you, Lambert, for calling the radio station. I have Untamed Simi on Twitter. He tweets at me. He says, good morning, Obilo. I'm impressed by those positive thinkers you have with you in the studio. These are the people that should be making policies and recommendations for the state. Hello. Good morning.
Hello, good morning, Mr. Desmond.
Mr.
My name is Comrade Ismail Adedamola, calling from Bashoro.
The comrade is here.
You see, what I wanted to say here is that Nigeria, we fail as a nation since we don't see ourselves as a one. And the bad policies we are practicing in this country is also responsible for the failure of our intelligence. Because if that one can be removed from there and we work together, PDP, NPC, and some other, think that, oh, the interest and the security of this country is paramount. Definitely, if they work together, definitely the country will experience it. But the situation where the politicians lost to their daughter, and they are looking for, and the opposition party, they are looking for the factor to campaign for the next election. So that one is a bad thing. Therefore, I recommend that the security issue, it is not a single responsibility. It is our collective responsibility, and everybody should take it very seriously. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Security is the responsibility of all.
Good morning.
Good morning.
This is okay.
Okay, good to hear your voice.
Yeah. Edmund, how are you doing?
I'm fine.
And the guest, good morning.
Good morning.
Edmund.
Good morning.
2 years ago, remember one of the traditional leaders in the North said something about the fight against Boko Haram being a fight against the North. Now, the revered Sultan now is coming out to say that there is actually war. We've always known this is existing. Now, the next thing we need, now he has said this, how do we curb it? The two gentlemen there have been able to profile one or two solutions. But Edmund, I still believe the traditional leaders have a great part to play in all this, whether we like it or not. One, they are the ones that have a go-in with the people within their area there. Dr. Jelly just talked something. There was something he denied. At the end of the day, he still came back to agree with what you asked earlier. So I think we need to sit down. Edmund, it boils down to what you always say. let's sit down and discuss. Good morning.
Good morning. Achukudi, you have gone to the Mambila Plateau. You have been around that axis. The last caller just raised the question of traditional rulers. Tell me, the interactions you had with the traditional system around those axes, what came out of them?
Okay, so I visited Taraba. I visited Benue State as well. And I had conversations with traditional rulers in Gashaka, Gumti, also in Taraba, also some religious leaders and other key stakeholders like the conservator of the Gashaka Gumti National Park. And there was a consensus amongst these leaders that the government at the federal, even at the state level, do not seek their opinion before taking some decisions and making some policies, which was quite surprising because one of the traditional rulers even cited an example that the rural grazing area project, which the federal government, the executive arm of the federal government, wanted to embark on in 2019, that they were not consulted. And he was like, they have in Taraba sufficient land for ranching, you know, and that there was really no need to bring up an idea of setting up ranches, rural grazing areas, in every part of the country, that Taraba State alone has sufficient land. And I would agree with him because traveling through the state, especially at the Gembu area, I noticed that there were ranches there already existing and they were doing really fine with very fat cows. So it was surprising to me that the traditional rulers, you know, were not really considered when bringing up some of the policies which was going to affect the populace of these same traditional rulers.
Now that brings us to the question, Adewale, you know, talking about clash of modernity and civilization. Because we all seem to see, let's go back to the traditional rulers, let them sort it out. And these are the same traditional rulers that don't have constitutional powers. Because when we say that, we clearly state that government has failed, that government cannot reach the people. Because normally there should be local government in those areas. So when we say go to the traditional rulers, I ask, what about the local government system?
Of course, I also agree to the fact that perhaps sometimes we have existing laws that, you know, see to some of these matters, but they are not effective. They are very weak laws. So, for instance, what you said about, you know, the local government ruler, I mean, maybe chairman or something, within the precinct of the Nigerian Land Use Act, the Tenure Act, there are stipulated, you know, provisions there that apart from, you know, the urban areas, or the urban lands controlled by the state, other areas of land under the local government should be controlled by the local government chairman. But what you see is that there is a kind of, how will I say, negligence of duty, sometimes on the part of the local government, because you don't even see them intervening much. And different kind of encroachers keep on coming onto the land until this kind of violence and terror acts are being carried out. And to talk about the traditional rulers, I do not have any alternative opinion about their participation within it. But I do think that we should also consider the extent to which some of these people are genuinely involved. You know, I keep on saying, talking about genuine involvement. I mean sincerity. Because like a previous study also carried out sometimes in 2018, you know, on the traditional rulers' involvement in farmer herder crisis. I can't get the name of the author now, but it was reported in that study that some of the community members alleged some traditional rulers to have collected money from some of these people without consultation with the community. And then these people came in with sense of entitlement into their lands. So there's a lot of, you know, factors involved in this. And I don't know. I just think that from the local government perspective, they need to, you know, work to the letter of the provision of the Land Tenure Use Act. They have to step in. They have to be active and proactive about this.
Achukwudu Njoku.
Yes.
Oshini just raised some points. about traditional rulers' involvement in some of this crisis. Did you notice that in your work?
Yes, in a particular community in Benue State, I interviewed some farmers who highlighted that there were some cases where when a case is taken to the traditional council, they suspect, because of course it probably wasn't a fact, but they suspected that there must have been some bribery which may have influenced the decision against them. Yeah, so some people raised those issues, but I still strongly believe that considering the importance of traditional and also religious leaders in Nigeria and how we know people respect these institutions, it's very important to sort out solutions to problems at such local levels. Yes, so what can be done is, fortunately in the north, like somewhere in Buhari in Abuja, for example, they have the Hausa population, they also have the Gwari population, and they have a traditional ruler for the Gwari people and the traditional ruler for the Hausa people. They have two of them like that. So such the social struggle institutions could have a combination of traditional rulers from both parties, such that to an extent, there can be solutions that will favor everybody.
We'll be back after this break. Don't go away.
State Affairs with Edmund Obilo is live.
Splash FM 105.5.
Uncle Dentist, what can be cavities? And how Colgate take they protect my teeth from cavities? Shey, they use Kung Fu?
No, dear. Now, hole for teeth, they cause most tooth pain will be cavity. But if you use Colgate Maximum Cavity Protection, take brush every day. The confirmed formula could help keep natural calcium inside our teeth. We could protect them from tooth decay.
Time don't reach. So upgrade to the chosen toothpaste Colgate. Because Colgate locks calcium in.
And the Nigerian Dental Association, they recommend Colgate.
1,000 naira. Plus 450. Minus 120. Plus...
Baba bon boy, what do you dey do with calculator since morning? One ride jam?
Jam, okay. No be make it Isaac Newton now. Now the price of grocery we will need for house. We don't summer up. Make me the rack brain so.
Ha! Baba bon boy, I no go agree you get grey hair quick quick. Now I hear say, Foodco don't come again with Foodco
Black Friday gidigba.
With up to 50% off for selected items for their Obodo market. 3 pounds
evaporated milk.
3 pieces now.
399.
Below it. Fuel 500 gram
900 naira.
Gin Exotic 1 liter na
300 naira.
Feed fueled evaporated milk 160 gram. 3 pieces at
449.
Hey, whoa. Make I dey go Foodco now.
I trust you. Baba bon boy, you know they carry last. Foodco Black Friday.
Digba.
Kuku Boku for Grand Berekete. While stock lasts from 27th to 29th November. Terms and conditions. Issues. Hey,
Babe, Grain Smart. Is it a flavor?
No, it's a special mix of vitamins and iron in Golden Moon.
But I thought Golden Moon was made from maize and soya.
Yes, Niger maize and soya protein fortified with Grain Smart, which means the right energy to think and do great things.
Oh!
Treat your family to the great taste and energy of Golden Moon. Eat up and carry go, because nothing do you. Golden Moon, make every day amazing.
Auto today. Baba keresi kon ni Splash FM ati Lagelu FM o bale bage. Sinu gbogbo Farm Small to wa lori Ring Road Ibadan. Bere lati ojo kini osu kejila titi di ojo kerinleni ogun. Nibi teyin ewe o ti ma gba ebo rabande latowo Baba keresi idije re sise laarin eyin ewe. Let ojo aje Monday titi di ojo Jimo la ma wole laarin ago mesan owuro si ago marun role to ba di ni ojo Saturday ago mesan owuro da ago meje asale lojo Sunday ago mokanla owuro titi di ago meje asale ni egberun kan fori kan ni o outele ilana ti ajo NCDC lakale pelu lilo ibomu ta mo si first mark fun ekunrere alaye e pe sori awon number yi 0805-699-8701 Tabi 0805-699-8703 Baba Keresi todun yi o ma larinrin ju.
Jane, I need to get to Solar Telecoms at Mokola now. I need to get an AC for the office and a TV set for the reception. Should I go to the Mokola or Challenge or Palms Mall? Or which do you think is closer? This should not take more than 30 minutes.
No, sir. It shouldn't even take up to 10 minutes. There's a new Solar Electronics store at J. Allen Dugbe, Ibadan.
New Solar Telecoms at J. Allen Dugbeke. When? How? Where?
Yes, sir. The Jagaban of electronics and phones in Ibadan, Solar Telecoms, has landed at J. Allen, Ibadan. Step up your game and visit Solar Electronics Showroom at number 15 Obafemi Awolowo Way, J. Allen, Ibadan today for the best flat screen and curved TV sets, AC units, gen sets, deep freezers, fridge, gas cookers, and lots more at the lowest prices.
Thank you for your patronage, sir. This is your special gift.
Lovely.
There's so much to go around at Solat Electronics Showroom at J. Allen. Visit us today and get yours too. Or call 0907-434-9785 or 0701-684-1630 or visit solatonline.ng. Solat Telecoms, the Jagaban of phones and electronics.
Uncle Dentist, what can be cavities and how Colgate take they protect my teeth from cavities? Say they use Kung Fu?
No, dear. Now, hole for teeth they cause most tooth pain will be cavity. But if you use Colgate Maximum Cavity Protection, take brush every day. The confirmed formula could help keep natural calcium inside our teeth. We could protect them from tooth decay.
Time don't reach. So upgrade to the chosen toothpaste Colgate because Colgate locks calcium in.
And the Nigerian Dental Association, they recommend Colgate.
Splash FM 105.5.
Daganan kilo kilo bedening kom no more.
No.
Di beta maso sanalom.
No.
Muasa benge kaputo.
Yeah.
State Affairs with Edmund Obilo.
Yeah.
Warriors, that shed innocent blood after people. Whoa, oh yeah. Whoa, Jah shall clean out the bad kids, yeah. And separate them from the good, cause the day of harvest is near. Whoa, 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 whoa. Jah shall clean out the bad weeds, yeah. And separate them from the good, cause the day of harvest is near. Whoa, 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 whoa. Woe be unto those that say their fish will, and they are not. Woe be unto those that say they choose, and they are not. Cause they shall be cast away, like the chaff that the wind driven away, I say. Oh yeah, oh well. Jah shall clean out the bad weeds, yeah. And separate them from the good, cause the day of harvest is near. Whoa, 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 whoa. Oh, oh, Jah shall clean out the bad weeds, yes. And separate them from the good, cause the day of harvest is near. Whoa, 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 oh, oh. Get to the black and white oppressors who have oppressed Jah children innocently. Oh, yes, I say. Fall, let Babylon fall. Jah shall clean out the bad weeds, yeah. And separate them from the good, cause the day of harvest is near. Whoa, 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 whoa. Oh, oh, Jah shall clean out the bad weeds.
I know you are asking the radio man, when would this day of harvest come? It is here. It is here. Just that you have refused to go to the farm.
Mm-hmm.
But those of us that have planted, we will reap. So plant now, it's never too late. Plant the seed of love. The seed of unity. Ayobami has tweeted at me. he says, to leave justice and truth behind in pursuance of progress, stability, and order will turn history into a haunting specter. Ayobami tweets saying, Nigerians are currently being haunted by the past because we have tolerated injustice and lies for fear of conflict. We are living in denial. Akintunde Bello is on Twitter. He tweets at the Radio Man. Remember, you can tweet at E. Obilo at Splash FM 1055. He says, good morning. To overcome Nigeria's security problem, an holistic approach is necessary. For example, high literacy and employment rates, conflict and inflow of small arms from neighboring countries, effects of climate change. That is why I'm worried. As Ethiopia battles itself, more arms comes into Africa. And remember, how do you know a strong country? It's also the strength of the borders of a country. It's a way of measuring if a country is strong. Because countries that are strong have the capacity to defend their borders. So do you want to say Nigeria is strong? Nigeria has porous borders. Porous borders. Nigeria has not shown the capacity to protect its borders. On Twitter, I have here at Lebi Owoboye. At Lebi Owoboye is here. It says, like Achebes once said, the trouble with us is leadership. Leadership should be before any other thing. Leadership should, before any other thing, be responsible for the security of lives and property. You can tweet at E. Obilo. Remember, you can watch us live on Splash FM page on Facebook. You can watch us on YouTube. So go on Splash FM page, watch us. You can also leave your comment on Splash FM page. I will migrate to Splash FM page soon on Facebook. Let's go on Instagram and see if there's a message for the Radio Man. Okay, I can find one here. Akim Olalekan is also here. Akim, I've taken your message on Facebook already. Ifemi Dayo. Aisoni. That's Lagbaja there. All right, Ifemi Dayo is saying, war is not an option at all. However, it's important to take the issue of insecurity head on and decisively. There is fire on the mountain, Olajide screams on Instagram. Fire on the mountain. Run, run, run. But don't run. We'll be fine. Olajide Ebenezer is saying there is fire on the mountain on Instagram. Now everyone is on the run, he says. Those who fear the fire can no longer stand its heat. Oh, it's time to come together and face our common enemy. And that common enemy is insecurity. We need to face it. But when we say Nigeria is at war against itself, remember, the people you want to face are Nigerians. You know, I was discussing with somebody yesterday. I said it's becoming more lucrative in places like Zamfara villages to be part of the bandit. It's getting more lucrative to be part of the bandit because it seems you will be safer if you are part of the bandit. At least you have gun. Then you become among the oppressors, not the oppressed. You know, if they give you the option of being an oppressor or being an oppressed, the likelihood is that you are going to choose being an oppressor. So more young persons would rather become bandits. Because remember, the Sultan says they go to the market, they buy things with their AK-47. The community know them. They are the children of the community. So they know the markets. They move in. They even collect taxes. They are now kidnapping policemen with ease. All right. Even when I smile, I feel the pain. Let's listen. Let's go back to Dr. Abdul Jalil Tafar Baluwa. Let's continue the conversation about the insecurity in northern Nigeria. If you come down south, There are different conspiracy theories about the plans of the Hausa Fulani. There is the talk about the movement of Amajiris from the north down south to stoke violence here. There is the talk of the Fulanization of the Nigerian state. And there is also the talk of Islamization.
The Fulanis have a small population. I think between 6 and 10% of the population of Nigeria. What type of infusion will make Nigeria, the rest of Nigeria, that is 90%, be Fulanized? Islamization in the western part of Nigeria, or the southwest, which is where Islam first entered into Nigeria, you will have families where a brother may be Christian and the junior or older brother can be Muslim. They have always been like that for centuries. So, about Islamization, I don't understand. Now, to bring Almajiris into the southern part of Nigeria, that makes very little sense to me also. Almajiris, as we know, as I told you, they're supposed to be students. But if they're looking for food all day and whatever paltry amounts that can be given to them as alms to take back to their imam, who is supposed to have been paid by their parents, what skills do they have to stoke some problems? Whoever is moving them to the south should be prosecuted to the fullest extent of the law, because he is looking for genocide of a generation of our children who will just be killed because they've been seen in another part of the country as invaders. And this will be unfair to these poor young lives. I think former Emir Sanusi of Kano and Governor El-Rufai have put it best, that we need to take care of these children, re-educate them, and make them useful for themselves. Some of them are older, so it will be very difficult to now start them with ABC. But they can be taught skills, maybe farming or some other handiwork for them to do, and the government can start them. I even thought of a revolutionary idea. Some of our children that have gone to polytechnics and universities that have not been able to get jobs, that if in each of the 19 states of the North, they can spend 6 weeks of a year to train these children with particular skills for some things, either to add value to things grown, either in husbandry or in direct agriculture. Give them 5 million naira each, 1 million of them. Give them 5 million naira each to just go and explore. In one generation, we'll have more millionaires in the north than you can imagine.
Dr. Balewa.
Yes.
You read the papers every day. You measure the political temperature. You tend to have this feeling of a rising hatred among the major ethnic groups in Nigeria. Some have said there is an alliance of other ethnic groups now against the Fulani hegemony. How do we stem it?
Thank you for that question. Because the governor of Kano State had said that Kano has enough land to be able to accommodate a lot of the herders. That is one. And recently, he said something even more succinct. He said we needed to be able to block herders coming from other countries into our country. The herders in Nigeria and the farmers in Nigeria have coexisted for eons. There has not been any problems, but some things have been happening in the last few decades. There has been an encroachment of the Sahara. About 600 meters of the Sahara is moving southwards every year, which means that behind those 600 meters will be real desert. So if the Fulanis in Nigeria, which are less than 10% of the population, have always coexisted with the farmers all the way down until this encroachment started, and herders from other countries that are nearby now started moving down to look for foliage and greenery, green pasture for their cattle. Of course, they don't understand our culture of coexistence, and they just see a lush green country and think that they have a right to go and destroy other people's farms. And I think Nigeria also need to rewrite some of the freedoms in ECOWAS about ECOWAS citizens having just freedom going from one country to another. I believe we're working on that, and it needs to be done as soon as possible. And when our borders are a lot more secure, we will have less of this, and we should have less problems, because the Nigerian and Fulani herders, who are usually very young people, because the herds belong to some bigger people back in their states, have always respected the rights of others to their crops and farms, will continue for as long as we can keep these other foreign herders out.
Should we be herding our cars in the way it's presently done? Is Nigeria not modernizing that we should begin to think of ranches?
Well, maybe ranches or ruga or whatever they want to call it will be a lot more profitable for all of us. Now, we have trained some forest rangers. They can be used as the police in these setups. Each state on a senatorial zone gives like 5,000 hectares, each state in the north, not only will we be able to get better meat, because these cows are not going to be walking miles and miles and miles every day, we can have rotational grazing. We can also have different types of cattle, those that will produce milk, those whose hides are a lot better, and those that will produce just meat alone. This can grow so many industries also, whereby we can have hustling industries within this establishment. We don't make a lot of toilet porcelains in Nigeria.
State Affairs with Edmond Obilo is live.
We're kicking some folks out of the market this season.
I tell you, okay, everyone else in this bed with me, they're losers.
We're the station that beats all the competition. And we'll prove it
as soon as we hear any competition.
105.5 Splash.
Mamas, una good morning, no. Help them to they smile every day for school. Make them they brush with Colgate Maximum Cavity Protection. Because Colgate locks calcium in.
It's coming out!
Splash FM 105.5.
Quick, charge a 240.
Hot news, cool vibes, sports, and more on the Integrity Station.
Hey, it's Tom and Priyanka signing in with your BBC Minute.
Hong Kong's leader Carrie Lam has said that she keeps piles of cash at home, as US sanctions mean she doesn't have a bank account. She's been penalised for the territory's crackdown on free speech since the introduction of China's national security law in June.
Next, Iran's President Hassan Rouhani says the assassination of a top nuclear scientist will not slow his country's nuclear programme. He's blamed Israel for the killing. Israel hasn't commented.
A coronavirus update from the world's hardest hit country, the US. The number of recorded cases there has now passed 13 million.
Around 90,000 people are currently in hospital with the virus, with a further spike expected soon due to families gathering during the recent Thanksgiving holiday.
And how do astronauts clean their clothes in space?
Well, normally they can't, but NASA might just have the solution.
Well, the space agency has signed an agreement with a US company to develop a waterless detergent to wash clothes whilst on board a spaceship.
Clever stuff. 829G.
BBC Minute.
Quick, charge a 240.
Hot news, cool vibes, sports, and more on the Integrity Station.
Don't dare touch that dial. It's Splash 105.5 FM, your Integrity Station.
In the global village of conflicting ideologies and complexities, understanding systems and schemes through awareness and social reconstruction becomes expedient.
They never told you how you offended them?
I'm not on trial, so I can't go before them.
Join the radio man, Edmond Obilo, on state affairs for local and international politics, security, extensive economic analysis, interviews, and world power play.
Nigerians must choose the path they want to follow. Follow the same looters and sponsors of violence who control the political structures, or encourage the formation of a new leadership team.
Be a global citizen and join the radio revolution on State Affairs. State Affairs with Edmond Obilo. Radio just got deeper.
Welcome back. The program is State Affairs on Splash 105.5 FM, the Integrity Station. I am Edmond Obilo. Remember, you can watch us live on Splash FM page on Facebook. On the front page of the Saturday Punch, Olufon's killing, Afeniferi tackles Buhari as Sultan, a laughing Olubadan decry insecurity. ASUU agrees to end 8-month strike. Lecturers get 70 billion naira. Dr. Jide Ololajulo is here. You must be happy. ASUU is ready to call off the strike. How do you feel?
Thank you, Edmund, for having me. I think it's more than 70 billion we're talking about here. It's more about what is happening in the universities in the country. And I'm sure that news is just sensational and an attempt to reduce the whole struggle to the issue of money. But I think it's not what we're talking about. By the time the government is ready for business in terms of dealing with the real problems in the Nigerian university system, I'm sure nobody will be talking about ASUU receiving some 70 billion naira from the federal government. What we want to see at the end of the day, those issues that ASUU raised, I want to see a situation whereby the educational system in Nigeria is promoted to the level, at least of what we have averagely in the Western world, in those places where the politicians send their children. I think it's because they realize that the quality is not good enough. That is why they are sending their children out of the country. So we want a kind of equal opportunities for the children of the politicians and then the children of the ordinary person. So this is not just about 70 billion naira. It's about what will happen in the next few months. We want to see those changes in the system. And I'm sure it's going to be so glaring for the rest of the society to see whether ASUU was being selfish in his agitation or the government was just being mischievous in his claims.
One of the ways to know a country dancing on the spot is to study the conflict between ASUU and the federal government over time. As a university student, there were times I spent months at home because of ASUU strike. More than 20 years after, it's still the same story. And Leaf's physicality can never grow. We are too religious and sentimental to move forward. That's the point Victor Ayomide Olaniyi is saying, or is making, on Facebook. He says religion has taken our minds. At a point, you begin to feel if the problem is religion. But once you study religion keenly, you just come up with the conclusion that religion is love, peace, harmony. That's what religion preaches. I read the Quran regularly. I have Bibles. And what I see is peace, love. Let's work together. Oni Omoshebi is saying war is selfishness. It is the desecration of human existence. War is insanity. It may be the dream of a maniac. It is the worst nightmare of nationhood. War bets no wins and leave no gains. Ruins and orphans are its relics. Its themes are tears and anguish. War is a fraud. It's a collage of unjustness and moral mediocrity. The most inhuman act of humans, hidden to so many, is its utter needlessness. That's a poem. You want to read it? You can go on my page on Facebook. You'll find it there. I would like to interview Oni Temitope Omoshebi. Omoshebi, can you send me a message? Inbox me on Facebook. I want us to discuss this poem. Let's talk about it. I like discussing poetry. John Paul Azuka is here. He says security of lives and property is topmost. Unfortunately, our leaders have failed in this aspect. Let's come back to the discussion. Njoku Chukwudi is here, a researcher. Njoku, what do we do? How do we solve the problems?
Okay, it's complicated, it's multifaceted, the problem I mean. But then solutions are not far-fetched. The approach from the government is militarization, security, sending soldiers out, sending the police out. But then the solution is more than just militarization. I believe the essence of research and development is really underplayed by the policymakers. So I think it's time for the policymakers to start adopting findings from research in making some of their decisions. Because as a postgraduate student doing a PhD, you know, you spend two to three years doing your program, and in as much as you try to reach out to these guys on some of the solutions to some of these problems, it seems as if they ignore you. In the course of my program, I find out that it's rather people from the international community who are approaching me I've been approached by a department in the University of Glasgow. I've presented my work at virtually at George Mason University. You know, I've gotten a travel grant to present the work in Barcelona. These people are interested in the work. They're interested in the solutions, but nobody from Nigeria, in as much as we put out what we're doing out there. So I believe the essence of research and development must not be underplayed. That will be a key step forward to finding solutions to the problem.
Chukwudi Badebonjoku is working on a PhD work entitled Pastoralist Farmers Conflicts in Nigeria, Socio-Ecological Drivers and Transformative Pathways to Addressing the Conflict. I can't wait to read your full work. When are you going to complete this project?
I'm already in the concluding stages, if not for COVID and ASUU strike. So I'm looking at concluding it towards the mid of next year. Yeah.
We are almost done.
Yes, and definitely I'm going to publish the results of the findings for, you know, everybody to see, and for those who are interested in, you know, making use of it, they can have access to it.
He is a PhD candidate at the Department of Geography and Environmental Science, University of Calabar. Adewale Owosheni is a PhD candidate in the Department of Philosophy, University of Ibadan. He also lectures there. Adewale, why are we not intellectually driven in our politics?
Of course, that's, I think that's a good question. In most sinner society, let me say, in quote.
Are you saying our society is not sane?
Well, I said sinner in the sense of, you know, comparing what is workable over there to what is not here.
Mm.
So when you go to, you know, maybe countries in Europe, say Norway, say Switzerland, and some other of these American places, you discover that there is a lot of connection between knowledge production and governance. In Nigeria, there is little or, you know, minimal attention given to, you know, education, which is the major driver of intellectualism. And it actually begins, you know, for instance, with how many percentage of the national budget is being given for education. It's even less than 5%, if not 6, or less than 6%. And HASU, for instance, is one of the, you know, one of the major body moving against such by calling for revitalization of the education system. But it seems that they don't see the universities, they don't see the education centers, they don't see them as, you know, the resort of consultation for governance. There's a lot of the connection, and you can see this even in the way our research is being done in the university. So I'm a PhD student now. The reason why perhaps I'm getting to pay subsidized fee for my school fees because I'm a staff of the university presently. There are so many students who do not have, you know, any forms of subsidized loans. And in fact, these people have, some of them have laudable projects that all they need is just some kind of grants or funding. The university is not providing that, and not even igniting maybe other collaborative agencies to do that. So you would see that the way they treat the hub of knowledge production itself is very dismissive. The government does not really, you know, seem to look at that direction. And when there is no injection of knowledge producing into what people face in everyday life, there is bound to be a lot of, you know, disharmony. There's bound to be a lot of disruption in the way policies are made and also. So the universities and education centers actually should be seen as a hub of knowledge production to direct, you know, policies and all.
Let me come to Dr. Ololajulo of the Department of Archaeology and Anthropology. I've read different articles written by intellectuals. And as I read them, I say, okay, but these are the solutions. How come government does not look into those works?
Yeah, thank you very much. I think we are dealing with what I call a national culture here. Let me start by saying that the beautiful work that is being done by Njoku, his thesis, may end up also on the shelf, not being read or not being taken seriously by the Nigerian government. And why is this so? It's because we have a kind of culture that try to debase whatever is produced locally. You can find this in all aspects of our national life, right from even the aspect of the football that we so much love. You look at the national team currently today, it's made up of almost 90% foreign-based player. You can be surprised that the same findings that Njoku's will arrive at will be taken seriously if that finding is actually communicated by a foreign researcher. So we are dealing with a kind of national culture that does not really value the local. And we've taken this to even the level of consumption. Even if it is food consumption, people don't even believe in the local rice, or what you call the Nigerian rice we produce. We still believe that the imported one should be better. Look at the current face-off between ASU and the federal government. Who knows that ASU could be able to come up with the UTAS software? The federal government underrated what we could do. And then we could see from their own testimony in the last few months that they believe that the UTAS is better than the IPPS that we are paying much for. So in the same way, that is the culture that we translate to every aspect of our national endeavor until we change this culture of believing that whatever is from the foreign is better than what is produced locally. I don't think we'll be going anywhere.
And what I have noticed in recent time is the speed at which Nigerians are searching for scholarship grants. It's becoming a trade. Mm-hmm. And I'm scared. What's going on?
Yeah, everyone is just trying to survive within this system because we have a system that does not recognize your effort if you don't try to maybe add a kind of international value to what you are doing. You could see it in the way people are sending children abroad to obtain masters, even in any university, anywhere outside Nigeria. Some go as far as going to Cotonou to come back with certain certificates just to reinforce the fact that they have come back with something foreign. So the scholarship, the fellowship people are looking for outside the country, they are a form of endorsement of their scholarship. So you find out that when you at any kind of forum and you don't want to read your citation and you don't have all those kind of international fellowship, international scholarship here and there, people look at it's just a local scholar.
A local champion.
It's not doing anything international. Mm. So that is what is driving this craze for fellowship everywhere. The same ideology that anything foreign is better than what we have locally.
We've lost confidence in ourselves.
We've lost confidence. Exactly.
Amassing weapon systems and building up defense and security manpower is the traditional concept of national security aimed at the relative freedom from harmful threats. The idea of stockpiling arms is freedom from war. They call it deterrence and victory in war if the arms are used well. But I make the point, like Chukwudi has said, armament only cannot guarantee security. Mm-hmm. If it were to guarantee security, the United States would have won in Vietnam, in Afghanistan, in Iraq. Al-Qaeda hit the twin tower of the World Trade Center in New York, in the world's greatest military power. I'm talking about a United States with super military technology, wide secret intelligence network, and enormous economic wealth. The Soviet Union collapsed despite its military power. These examples highlight the limitations of militarism while neglecting other pressing variables. Remember, survival is the attainment of peace and progress of the individual and society. It's a reflection of the economic and political conditions of the state. The point I'm driving at is this. The strength of the army is measured by the economic condition of the state it defends. The armies of advanced states are more efficient by reason of institutional efficiencies. The United States of America is the largest economy in the world, and the character of the army is seen in the wealth of the United States. Mm-hmm. Let's examine one of the characters of the Nigerian economy as a measure of national insecurity. The group managing director of the Nigerian National Petroleum Corporation, Mele Yari, on Thursday, 26 November 2020, reveals the country's refineries were shut down because it is practically impossible to run pipeline at their optimum capacity. He complains of the vandalization of the corporation's pipelines. The GMD's assertion is in the presentation of the 2021 budget proposal before the House of Representatives Joint Committee on Petroleum Upstream, Downstream, and Gas. Hear him. For instance, to run Kaduna and Warri refineries, you need to deliver 170,000 barrels of oil per day so that both will operate at 70% capacity. Hey, the NNPC cannot undertake such target at the moment because it cannot protect its pipelines from vandals. Here the GMD. I can tell you today that except the Atlas Cove to Ibadan line and also the Port Harcourt to Aba line, none of these pipeline is serviced. We are talking about 5,000 kilometers of pipelines with 13 fuel depots. He continues, we cannot flow product into these pipelines. The cheap one is to say that the pipelines are aged. But the real reason is that the level of activities of vendors on these lines is gross, monumental, and profound. He says about 43 billion naira was lost to oil theft and vandalism between January and June 2020. According to him, the NNPC attends to about 80 vandalization points every month, leading to the corporation to resort to supplying fuel by tankers through 13 fuel depots to different parts of the country. The vandalization of pipelines is clearly one of the greatest threats to national security. I hope you understand that. You know, we have power stations built everywhere, gas power stations, but we cannot power those stations because we cannot pipe gas to those stations. So therefore, we don't have electricity. You can see the dangers trailers are causing, tankers are causing on our highways. That's to tell you one of another side of the national security problem. Dr. Nalojo, I want to get your points on the crisis in the northern region. The violence there, does it scare you?
Yeah, thank you very much. I think the violence in the north must scare any patriotic Nigerian because we have this saying that among the Yoruba that whatever touches the eyes or whatever afflicts the eyes afflicts the nose. So there is no way you can say there is problem in northern Nigeria that does not really concern people living outside that geopolitical space. But when we want to look at it critically, maybe I start from the previous point you made about the Nigerian state and the insecurity. I want to see the Nigerian state as the bandit and the vandals. And there is this particular way in which the Nigerian state itself is a threat to its own security. Why do I say this? When you have a state that is illegitimate in its composition, when I say illegitimate, I'm not talking about election. I'm not talking about winning election. I'm talking about a situation whereby the citizens themselves don't trust the state. We talk about an illegitimate state. When we talk about a situation whereby the state has to impose itself on the citizen, we are talking about an illegitimate state. This is the situation we have virtually in every part of the country. Sometimes ago, when the vandalization thing was happening in the Niger Delta, there was this joke that the Niger Delta youth decided to break the pipelines because anytime the youth talk to the government about development, every plan is usually in the pipeline. So the youth decided to break the pipeline to see those plans for themselves. So when you talk about Northern Nigeria, talk about the terrorism, you talk about the banditry, we are talking about a situation of a long-term aggression against the people. We're talking about a situation whereby the elite have over the years decided to pauperize the people, and you find the system now fighting back. Those youth that we believe were docile, those youth that we believe were complacent, those youth that we believed have been dominated by religious indoctrination of just subjecting themselves to the authority of whoever is rich in the community, these youth are now fighting.
They are on rampage in Zamfara.
They are on rampage everywhere.
They are on rampage in Katsina. Nigerian young persons like you, Chukwudi, Njoku, are on rampage. Mm-hmm. Do you have any message for them?
I believe what is going on, of course, like he said, it's a feedback of the current insecurity, the current hunger in the country, and poverty, which has been highlighted by international organizations, and which, of course, we're experiencing here. But I think the youths can sit back, and not sit back by not being docile, but sit back and see how they can put in their own efforts in making the country, you know, better. I think the youths have a huge role to play in making sure things get better by probably, for some people, getting literate, for some other people, getting jobs to do, creating jobs by themselves, learning some kind of trade, and improving on themselves. By these ways, you know, they can have jobs to do, they can have power through their voice when they are literate, and, you know, things can get better from there.
At a point, governors like El-Rufai and Masari paid the bandits to calm down. They did not calm down. And they collected the money. And now they are coming to town to say, you must give us the money, forcefully. And the state seems helpless. Tell me more.
Yes, I feel that sometimes when you have to look at the approach of, you know, paying people to calm down, it might not be enduring. Mm-hmm. It might not be enduring. Because basically what you have to do, or what I think should be done, is you create a sustainable, you know, environment, a conducive environment. So what are these youths? What are they clamoring for? They want, you know, a resourceful environment where they can also flourish, where they can also survive and live, just like any normal person. So if you are now coming out to pay them, it will just only step down the hunger for the moment. And already, since they know that is the strategy the state or whoever did that is using, they would always come up again. Once they finish what they are paid with, they will come for more. They are like Oliver Twist.
Mm.
And they will weaponize themselves to hack some more.
They will weaponize themselves. Senate leader Yahya Abdullahi states that 350 million of the 500 million illegal arms in West Africa are in Nigeria. Mm-hmm. Let's go back to 2014 when Goodluck Ebele Jonathan was the president.
The Boko Haram insurgency in Nigeria is one of such condemnable acts of terror. We have continued to deploy human and military intelligence in close collaboration with our partners to bring an end to their nefarious activities. Greater regional cooperation in intelligence gathering and control of intelligence will ensure not only Nigeria's security, but also the security of our neighbors. A great threat to our collective human and national security is the rising menace of the use of small arms and light weapons. Out of the 500 million illegal small arms and light weapons in the world, an estimated 100 million are in Africa, with ECOWAS taking about 10% of this, and this in the hands of non-state actors. Africa has had enough of wars, and the cost of wars and insurgencies are too high. It has been estimated that Africa loses $18 billion per year from wars as well as insurgencies.
Splash FM 105.5.
You love Afrobeats, but your playlist is full of Fuji music. How refreshing it is to be transparent like our new bottle that's easier to recycle. Sprite, new bottle, same hit of lemon and lime.
Owuro akoto eto ni koni Splash FM 105.5 ni gbogbo ojo Monday si ojo Sunday laarin ago maro abo itaji si mefa 5:30 a.m. to 6 a.m. pelu wole olorun alai apostle SMO Mustafa JP baba sebi oba iri owuro oro olorun pe gbogbo eni to ba wa mi ni kutukutu won ri mi anfani ni fun o lati ni ibapa de olorun ninu aye baba sebi oba ni koni Splash FM 105.5 lojo jumo lati ojo Monday this Sunday, lago maro abo itaji si mefa. Fun won na lati di aladun Olorun nipasẹ ranṣẹ. Iwo na ma darapo lojojumo lago maro abo itaji 5:30 a.m. si mefa. Ogbe iseju ise agbara lategun pelu Olorun ninu aye baba sebi oba. Apostle SMO Mustafa Ijo Seed of Christ Golden Church International. Lo so nigbo wo e iri owuro lojojumo ni kan iri ise agbara to sara oto nigba be.
Auto today. Baba keresi kan ni Splash FM ati Lagelu FM o balẹ bagẹ. Sinu gbọ̀ngàn Palms Mall tó wà lórí Ring Road Ibadan bẹ̀rẹ̀ láti ọjọ́ kìíní oṣù kejìlá títí di ọjọ́ kẹrìnléní ogún níbi tí ẹ̀yìn ìwé ó ti máa gba ẹ̀bùn rabandẹ látọwọ́ Baba keresi ìdíje eré ṣíṣe láàrin ẹ̀yìn ìwé. Látọjọ́ ajé Monday títí di ọjọ́ Jímọ̀ láwọn àwọlé láàrin aago mẹ́sàn-án òwúrọ̀ sí aago márùn-ún rọ̀lẹ́ tó bá di ní ọjọ́ Sátidé aago mẹ́sàn-án òwúrọ̀ dago méje àṣálẹ́ lọ́jọ́ Sunday aago mọ́kànlá òwúrọ̀ títí di aago méje àṣálẹ́ ni ẹgbẹ̀rún kan forí kan ni ó. A ó tẹ̀lé ìlànà tí àjọ NCDC là kalẹ̀ pẹ̀lú lílo ìbòmú tá a mọ̀ sí face mask. Fún ẹ̀kúnrẹ́rẹ́ àlàyé ẹ pè sórí àwọn nọ́mbà yìí 0805-699-8701 tàbí 0805-699-8703. Baba kérésì tọdún yìí ó máa lárinrin jù.
This Christmas, the best present you can give is to be present. Put your phones away during lunch and dinner and give your loved ones something only you can give. Yourself. Coca-Cola wishes you a very Merry Christmas.
1,000 naira
plus 450
minus 120
plus.
Baba bon boy, what do you dey do with calculator since morning? You wanna ride jam?
Jam, okay. No be make like Isaac Newton now.
Now the price of grocery wey we need for house.
We don't summer up. Make me the rack brain so.
Ha, Baba bon boy, I no go agree you get grey hair quick quick. Now I hear say Foodco don't come again with Foodco
Black Friday gidigba
with up to 50% off for selected items for their Obodo market. 3 pounds
evaporated milk,
3 pieces now
399.
Below if fuel 500 grams,
900 naira.
G-Exotic 1 liter,
300 naira.
Feed fueled evaporated milk, 160 grams, 3 pieces at 449.
Hey, whoa, make I go Foodco now.
I trust you. Baba bon boy, you know they carry last. Foodco Black Friday.
Digba.
Kuku Boku for Grand Berekete. While stock lasts from 27th to 29th November. Terms and conditions. Hey, oh.
Flash FM 105.5.
Daganan kilo kilo bedening gom no moham.
No.
Di beta maso sanalom.
No.
Uasa benge kaputo.
Yeah.
State Affairs
with Edmund Obilo.
Yeah.
Dr. Jide Olola Julo, you heard Jonathan there in 2014.
Exactly.
Can you break it down?
You see, when people say we are moving in a kind of cycles, I think that is what I can take from that speech. When you compare Jonathan's speech 4 or 5 years ago with what we have today, I think if we just remove the date and you put the current date there, it still applies to what we currently have. It's a simple indication that the years are rolling, but we are not making progress as a nation. It's a simple attestation to the fact that we are not winning this war against terrorism. Forget whatever statistics anybody is coming up with. Forget whatever report anybody is coming with. The way you know you are winning a war is when the people can feel secured. So any assurance can be made by anybody about what is happening, whether in the northeast, whether it is in the north central. But the more I feel insecure as a person, the more I know that there is crisis in the country.
Let's look at this headline on the front page of the Saturday Punch. Gunmen kidnap Akeredolu's chief of staff's wife. Three orders. It's getting closer. Have you seen the headline? Niger Delta militants make fresh demands, threatening attacks on oil facilities. Mm-hmm. Have you seen this one on the front page of the Tribune? Kidnappers on the prowl. That is the banner headline on the front page of the Tribune. Kidnappers on the prowl. Governor's chief of staff's wife abducted in Ondo. Police officer shot dead. Chinese contractor kidnapped in Ekiti. Ajaokuta Steel Company workers kidnapped in Kogi. We are in serious security crisis, Governor Akeredolu speaks. Did you hear that? Let's listen to President Muhammadu Buhari. He made this speech in 2019.
Fellow Nigerians, your excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, we know that there exists a strong correlation between economic inequality and insecurity. When economic inequality rises, insecurity rises. But when we actively reduce inequality through investments in social and hard infrastructure, insecurity reduces. The disturbing increase in rates of kidnapping, banditry, and other criminal activities can be attributed to the decades of neglect and corruption in social investment, infrastructure development, education, and healthcare. This issue is further compounded by the impact of our changing climate and ecology. The ECOWAS and Sahel regions, starting from Chad all the way to Mali, are also experiencing adverse impacts of drought and desertification, which have triggered waves of human displacement, conflicts between farmers and herdsmen, terrorism, and a fundamental socio-economic change to our way of life. These issues are regional and not unique to Nigeria alone. The problems call for increased regional and international cooperation in developing a sustainable solution. As chairman of ECOWAS, I will be hosting a regional security summit of heads of states in the Sahel to develop a joint strategy to continue our efforts in addressing these issues.
State Affairs with Edmund Obilo is live.
You heard the president there. Is he on point?
Well, sometimes I wonder the nature of the Nigerian government anyway. They are easy. They also have the Google eyes to see where these problems are. And they are very good at the rhetorics. You know, for the president to have said, okay, economic inequality equals to insecurity, he admits that the state is not doing much in that direction. But at the same time, for the impasse of terrorism and all these other ugly incidences, I would have expected that, except maybe what he meant by international cooperation, is, you know, beginning from the region, interregional cooperation. And the way he is speaking, you know, in the full place of being the ECOWAS chairman, and then he's more or less pushing the pressure of, you know, a problem that should first of all have been sorted from a local point of view before throwing it out for, you know, a regional or inter-regional cooperation. And those are the things I find a bit paradoxical in his statement. So I don't know how to make sense out of some of these contradictions most times. So it really makes me think the government is obliterating its sole responsibilities and duties first.
Stephen Titiloe is on Facebook. He says the service chiefs need to be changed for new security strategy. Ignatius Owen says it has to be now or never. This government has taken people for granted for too long. Now they will learn the hard lesson that you cannot fool all the people all the time. Is it government that is learning the lesson, or we are all learning the lesson? Because once the country is enveloped by violence, I'm telling you, this political elite will take off. They are the first to take off. They are the first to run to America and London because they have the means to take off. So it's you and I that will be here battling it. So that when you say these guys will learn, the Tinubu is, they have private jets. They don't even need to apply for visas. They already have their passport stamps. They can just jet out now. So when you say it's good, what is happening? I warn you, don't say it is good. It is the poor that always pays the price. Women and children, they have nowhere to run to. So they will meet the burden of war. So we must begin to talk to our religious leaders now, our fathers, our mothers. We must begin to talk to our sons and daughters. If you are a young person, you are thinking of getting a gun, you don't need it. What we need now is the will to do good, to say, okay, we've arrived at this point. Let's assume we've all sinned, and it's time to redeem ourselves. Okay, that is what I feel we should be doing now. Look at this story on the front page of the Saturday Tribune. Nigeria's security has collapsed. That's coming from Afeniferi. Ondo in serious security crisis. Akeredolu cries out. You find that on the front page of The Nation. APC governors woo party's neck. It seems the politicians are more interested in playing politics. Dr. Jide? Because you see here them jostling up and down, APC, PDP, and when the country is on fire.
You see, let me say this because of the little knowledge I have about politicians. As far as this country remains, even if it is its carcass that remains, the politicians will be interested in who governs that carcass of the state. So when we have situation like this, we expect people to demonstrate a statesmanship. We expect them to be more sensitive to the situation in the country. But unfortunately, we are dealing with a group of people who don't care about what is happening as far as they can stay in power. I think the objective of staying in power is more paramount than seeing the whole crisis itself resolved.
But there are now boundaries who are even taking power. Clearly, you can see that in the north.
You see, the question of bandits taking power, I think, is one of those areas of challenge for them. But it is also an area that they use to also negotiate power. When there is crisis, you always expect politicians to also profit from it. Sometimes they thrive in crisis situation. Sometimes they create and generate crisis as a way of perpetuating themselves in power. You can never underrate politicians. Some of the stuff we see around, you imagine whether it is possible for people to create a crisis situation just because he wants to remain in power. But we have seen this. We've seen a situation whereby people use crisis to negotiate ethno-regional involvement in leadership. We've seen where people use crisis as a way of making claim to political ascendancy. So when you see all of these, they are actually disturbing. But for me, it is not so easy to just wave it aside that politicians are enjoying it. They are not just enjoying it. They may equally have their hands in some of these crises as a way of remaining in power.
But I also know that during periods of great crisis, great leaders emerge. Chukwudi, have you seen that possibility in Nigeria?
Yes, I've seen it. But in most cases, especially like in Africa, history has shown that where leaders even arise out of conflict, maybe there's so much suffering and then there's a coup, you see that the great leader eventually turns out to be a bad leader, not the savior. There have been cases like that. So it calls for worry, and in as much as there's much responsibility for the leader, I believe the people also have a significant role to play, because most times we are like a picture of what the society is as a people. And if we're not doing well as a people, you shouldn't expect so much from the leader. So I believe we give too much emphasis on the role of the leader and forget about the role of the people.
The role of the people. Okay, let's open the phone lines before we go. Let's take some calls. Remember, make it brief. Just hit the nail on the head because we don't have much time anymore. 080-915-51055. And 080-569-98678. You can call 070-694-93000. Good morning.
Good morning, Edmund.
Yes, good morning.
Yeah, my name is Mustafa Dira, calling from the world.
All right.
Yeah, Edmund, what I want to say this morning is that we all understand that there is a problem already, and the solution will be finding. But there are many people and many youths that are very, very much angry. Let me give you a very typical example. Do you know NISA, Nigerian Institute of Social and Economic Research?
Yeah.
Edmund, do you know the place?
Yes, I know the place. Ojo.
Yes, what are they doing? Nothing. We haven't seen them giving us solutions to our economic problem.
We are saying they are not reading the solutions. Their research is going on, but nobody cares about the findings.
Yeah. Let me tell you, if you don't put a rank peg in a rank hole, you'll be having problems. Look at that place. A research is being headed by a dentist. And you can just imagine, what do you think will come out of the place?
It's a dentist, not a scholar. Hello, let's get something right. Are you saying a dentist cannot make political sense?
No. Let me tell you, there are times when you have to put professionals.
Who is a professional? I don't know if it's a dentist that is there. I'll have to research that.
Okay, let me give you this, Edmund. During the time of Dr. Dudo Jonathan, his government, do you know that we have technocrats running the government? People like Dr. Okonjo Iweala.
And we became rich.
And the things were a little bit okay then.
Which okay? Why did we vote him out?
Because of the system. Because of the system. When we have a system that is not working, we are going to be having problems.
You are not hitting the point. A system that is not working, that is the point. That's what I'm taking away from your contribution.
I know you will never agree with me because you know this thing.
No, it's not about agreement. All right, thank you.
Thank you.
I appreciate you. It's not really about agreement, you know. What does it take to head a research institute?
Hello, good morning.
Hello.
Good morning. I speak according from Mokola Badari.
All right, hit the nail on the head.
The matter of this administration are too professional in finding fault without any remedy. Here and there, on a daily basis, economic problems, what are the remedies they are looking for? They keep on repeating the same thing without any solution on it. As a matter of fact, it's according to the purpose of the government with the liberals. The person that we're supposed to run to is the one shouting in those states now. Who is helping him? Who is coming to his aid? Because he is the one supposed to run to, you know, those things. He is number one citizen of those things. And he is the one shouting now. Who is coming to his aid? That's the commissioner. That is a question for his own. Good morning.
Who will save Akeredolu? That's the question the last caller has just asked. Akeredolu needs help. Will Buhari save him? Now look at another sad story here. How we sold policemen's skulls for 1,000 naira. We have moved to the state of nature. That is where we are. Wow, Dr. Lola Julo.
That's scary.
It is.
It's scary. And I think we are gradually resorting to self-help. And there is no way this one will not come into place. In the last few weeks, I've observed after the NSAS protest that there is virtually no police presence in the city of Ibadan. You drive around the city, you don't see police. And there's no policing going on currently. And then...
I see some. I see one even driver.
Maybe with the path that I tread on daily basis that usually have police, we don't have.
But they are scared. The truth is that they are scared.
Even the police are scared. So if the police people are also scared, you wonder what will happen to the ordinary person. The truth is that there is a kind of anger in the country generally. Everybody is angry, and I try to tell people that when you have any issue with anybody, you try to play it down because the temperature of an average Nigerian is just on the high side. We don't know who can easily get frustrated and then use weapon on you. I've experienced some of these things, and you realize that there is need to maybe calm down, just like that little boy said. Maybe there is need to calm down. But how do you tell hungry people to calm down? It's very difficult. One of the things I observed about the path we are taking as a country is that we expect a kind of magic to happen in the country. And I can't see a situation where any magic will save us. The population, I observed this, different forum I've spoken, that Nigeria population is no longer an asset. And it's like we are not really taking this into consideration.
It has become a burden.
It's a real burden. And then if we don't do something about it, I am sure we have to be complaining every time there is a new administration. This one came with a lot of promises, but I'm very sure today they themselves know that it is no longer a situation of love. It's not a case of people going to give you any time again. This current administration have been given enough time, and I think it's time. Maybe they've wasted all the goodwill that they have. Thank you.
All right. Akeredolu launched Amotekun. Yet, the roads have been taken over by bandits. In Oyo, the leopard man is in town. That's Seyi Makinde. How far? I hope the bandits will be chased out. Can Amotekun stand the heat? Questions to be answered by the states of Southwest Nigeria. We just have to go. But remember that poverty and social injustice are great threats to national security. The conditions of poverty are hunger, disease, illiteracy, and despair. At this point in our national existence, we should be mindful of the inflammable tensions spawned by poverty. It leads to extremism, unrest, and insurrections. A secure state preserves the well-being of the people and advances their prosperity. Until we do that, hey, the bullets get closer. But remember, I have come to be a solution to the Nigerian question. Watch out for me. I don't know what you think about yourself. We will build a new country. We will fly so high. We will learn from the lessons of terrorism and banditry. And we will build a Nigeria that offers everybody prosperity. Whether you are a Fulani, Yoruba, Ijo, Igbo, Urubo, Tiv. Chukwudi Njoku, thank you for featuring on State Affairs.
Thank you very much. A huge pleasure, I must say.
I appreciate you.
You're welcome.
Adewale Owusheni, thank you for coming.
Thank you for inviting me, Mr. Edmund.
Owusheni is of the Department of Philosophy, University of Ibadan. And Dr. Jide Olola Julo is of the Department of Archaeology and Anthropology, University of Ibadan. Next week is another time. I am Edmund Obilo. I worked with Bosun Alayode to bring you this edition of the program. Thank you for listening.
Daganan kilo kilo bejani gom lomoham.